What a timely topic, because I do feel like in this environment, building a reputation, maintaining a reputation, the norms just don't exist anymore. So we have an amazing panel to talk about. Two things, though. Two smarter, way smarter individuals than me have said it so simply, so clearly. It takes many good deeds to build a good reputation and only one bad one to lose it. Thank you, Benjamin Franklin. And then someone that we think about a lot here at Bloomberg, Warren Buffett. It takes 20 years to build a reputation, 5 minutes to ruin it. So let's get into building a corporate reputation and brand. With me, next to me, is Stephen Hahn-Griffiths. He's the Chief Reputation Officer of the Reputation Institute, works with lots of companies, Fortune 500 companies, has worked both with Aflac and Estee Lauder. Also with us, Catherine Hernandez-Blades. She's the Senior Vice President, Chief Brand and Communications Officer at Aflac. You can make the duck noise. Let's all do it. And Alexandra Trower. She is Executive Vice President, Global Communications at the Estee Lauder Companies, and really great perspective because you have so many brands under that umbrella. So let's get into it. So building a great brand, building a great corporate reputation. Catherine, I want to start with you. And I kidded about the duck, but I did have the duck on my desk for many years. But it does make, you know, that is an interesting object that you think about Aflac right away. But it is about more. It's about the company. It's about your core. It's about your core products. Tell me a little bit about developing a brand for Aflac.
Well, and it is about business. We have a $32 billion market cap. About $20 billion of that, according to Interbrand, is on the brand. That's a huge responsibility. So to be able to quantify return on reputation is critical. And we partnered with Reputation Institute. As you know, their model demonstrates 7 dimensions of reputation. Behind those 7 dimensions are 23 attributes, and it's weighted by industry. So we looked at an environmental scan, the motto itself, and learned that if we went after citizenship, workplace, and governance, where we had a great authentic story, we could get almost 50% lift on that model. And we started
50%.
50% of the model.
Wow.
We could also use a formula to quantify return on reputation. But just as importantly, now when I go in to brief the board, it isn't all of this feel-good stuff that we do. I take our pulse score, I overlay our social media sentiment, our editorial media sentiment, our sales, and our stock price. And I can't say that there is causation because we don't isolate the metric down to that finite level, but you definitely see correlation when you look at these charts, and it's very, very powerful.
Yeah, and let me just add, I'm so grateful to the Reputation Institute because we are all in a world that's super competitive. And there is nothing like going into your CEO and CFO's office to say, here's where we rank. And if you're not ahead of your competitors, that is not a good day for you.
Right.
So it's a fantastic way to get the budget you need to drive the reputation that you want to achieve. And so I am just so grateful to have those resources.
So come on in.
Well, we're very grateful too. And, you know, we have an adage where we sort of talk about the whole premise of you can't effectively manage what you don't measure. So as a starting point, be able to benchmark your organization relative to the companies you care about amongst the stakeholders that matter. And importantly, the link you can now attribute to business success is critical. So in many ways, reputation should be on the dashboard of every company at a board level, at a CEO level, because we know it moves markets, it moves the world.
Stephen, when you go into a company, whether it was Estee Lauder or Aflac or some of the other companies that you've, so many of the other companies that you've worked with, how do you figure out, though, what's the right strategy? What are the right benchmarks? We often here at Bloomberg look at, you know, stock price and earnings growth and things like that. How do you decide what are the right metrics?
So you have to really figure out what matters. And as Catherine alluded to, there are fundamentally 7 core dimensions and 23 attributes, and you can conduct what we call derived importance analysis to figure out what really matters for your company and how you can move the needle. And obviously you can do that on a normative basis by comparing and contrasting against your universe. And whether you link reputation to share price value or increase in sales or the potential to reduce churn, there's implications. There is an outcome to your ability to better measure and manage reputation. That's what we try and help advise companies on. And for each company, there's a unique story that allows them to win and be more successful.
Kevin, I want you to talk to a little bit about, you guys have gotten, you've had a very long relationship with the Aflac Cancer Center. Tell me about how that certainly seems like a good thing to do, right? But how that has helped the brand.
Oh, it's my favorite thing to talk about, Carol. So thank you for asking that question. 23 years ago, a fund development professional from the Children's Healthcare of Atlanta organization met with our CEO asking for a $25,000 donation. He was so moved, he said, I'm not going to give you $25,000. I'm going to write you a personal check for $3 million, and I want the naming rights. And that's how it began. And if you look at how marketing is evolving, oh, by the way, over that 23-year period, we've donated $131 million to the research and treatment of pediatric cancer.
Which is great.
Which is fantastic.
And
it speaks to, thank you. It really speaks to business stepping in where there's a government void. Because of all of the money the United States earmarks for cancer research and treatment, less than 4% goes to pediatric cancer research and treatment. And our premise is 4% is not enough. It's authentic to us. We've got a great narrative. Our employees love it. But again, as the world changes, as marketing moves from what we used to know as the four P's, price, promotion, placement, blah, 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 to the four E's, where you create an experience, you create an environment, you build engagement, and you're not selling, but it's an exchange. We actually brought the duck to life in the form of a robotic companion for children with cancer called My Special Aflac Duck. And basically, children have difficulty expressing their feelings, so we have feeling cards. So when the child life specialist comes in and says, Alex, how's your duck feeling today? Because Alex may be 3 years old and doesn't understand what nervous is. So the duck actually acts out the emotion for the child. It has a port, so the child can take back their power through medical play. There's some augmented reality activities through an app, but we spend about $3 million a year on the program, and we're dedicated to donating one to every child who's newly diagnosed with cancer in the United States free of charge. Going beyond that, we just got the data back from you guys. We have only done PR on this. Very grassroots. I think we paid for one television placement, and that's it. 15% of people in the country have heard of My Special Aflac Doc, and every one of them is more likely to buy our product because of our philanthropic commitment, the way we have innovated our little duck into life, and it's so rewarding.
Well, and I think about Alex, you guys at Estee Lauder have done so much through Evelyn Lauder, you know, in terms of breast cancer and so on. I mean, these are things that are obviously great programs, but I think about people are wondering, right, what's, and I hate to be so black and white, what's the payback, especially when you're publicly held companies?
Yeah, so I'm so glad you mentioned that. So we're kind of a strange hybrid. We are a family-controlled public company who went public in 1995. And this was a cause, the breast cancer campaign, very authentic to us because Mrs. Evelyn Lauder actually had breast cancer at a time when no one was talking about breasts or cancer. And she and Alexandra Penny created the pink ribbon. But for us, one of the things that is most important, we're all in this global war for talent. And employees want to feel like they're part of a company that is authentic, that cares, that lives their values. So for us, this is very authentic to us, but it's also a fabulous way to engage all of our employees around the world in a really meaningful way where they feel like they're making a difference. And we know from employee surveys that this is one of the things that they're most proud of, being part of the Estee Lauder companies.
Well, and why this is so important, I'll get back to that, because I want to bring you in for a second. Because
sure.
Something you said to me was 80% of the valuation of any company is based on the intangibles, the sense of purpose.
Correct. So those intangibles kind of reflect the emotional connection or the belief system that you have that you can attribute to any given company. And so perhaps 25 years ago, the reverse may have been true. It's less about the tangibles and more about the tangibles of how you evaluate a company. And I think what we've seen here in the two examples of Aflac and Estee Lauder is that the whole premise of not just philanthropy or cause marketing, But a commitment to corporate responsibility mm-hmm. is critically important. And there's a day and age where it created goodwill. Today, it's not just goodwill, it's good business. And so we see that whole premise of aligning with a deeper sense of purpose has the ability to, as we found with Estee Lauder, the ability to connect the best talent in the world because they join your company based on your values mm-hmm. and your belief system. Or in the case of Aflac, it translates to increase in sales. So there's a reward, if you will, for companies to do the right thing. It's no longer optional, it's a prerequisite in today's economy.
Right, we've seen that certainly with the rise of ESG investing, with impact investing. You know, you see the big private equity firms and the investment firms saying, these are things that we're looking at. So when you, Stephen, go into a company, I'm curious, the first thing you sit down, do you say, all right, guys, you got to figure out what you stand for, and whether it's starting, research or a research foundation. I mean, is that the priority initially, or what do you do?
Well, actually, the starting point is, let's tell you what the people you care about believe about you. So we're not making a recommendation in the absence of knowledge and insight, and we're a data and insights company right. that essentially survey multiple stakeholders. So whether we are talking to a member of the media, an employee, an investor, a customer you'd like to win over, a policymaker or a regulator, we're asking their perceptions of your company, and we're breaking it down based on the degree of emotional connection, which is what we call the pulse score, which is a measure of your reputation. We deconstruct those things that matter, the drivers or the reasons to believe, and we align it with the trigger points of the intended desire for your business. And so when you have that full system, if you will, of understanding, you can now make the smart choices. So our job is not to necessarily make recommendations, but provide the insights upon which companies can now make smart decisions and ultimately impact the business.
Okay, so now I want to throw in social media, because I feel like, you know, in an instant, the trending on a company or an individual can change so quickly. Alex, talk to me a little bit about this. You said to me, in managing a brand, developing a brand, social media has changed everything.
Oh my gosh, hasn't it? I mean, who sleeps anymore? Social media is so 24/7, it's so around the world. And you know, I love it actually, because I love the fact that it's this wonderful democratic platform where everybody can have a voice.
And that's why we hate it, because everybody
can
have a voice.
And so the flip side of that is that one tweet from a country like China can gain momentum in 20 minutes. And so that's why monitoring super, super closely is so important, both with real tools, but with people. You know, we're all about judgment. And so if you don't marry those two, you're never going to really understand if something is possibly harmful to your reputation. And the other piece I would just add is, and I can say this because I've led some boneheaded decisions, you've got to respond in a locally relevant way. Do not think because you're sitting in New York City or San Francisco or London that you have any idea how the woman in southern India feels when she thought that her foundation shade was right for her and she traveled and she spent $40 for it and it didn't work. And so you've got to be really locally relevant, and you've got to put yourself in the shoes of that consumer, or even if it's an activist group, mm-hmm. to really understand what their point of view is and where they are. But social media is really, really wonderful, but it can make life challenging.
I want to just follow, because you guys, I think I counted on your website, 29 brands.
32.
Got to update the website, maybe.
Yes.
But what's interesting is you also rely on influencers.
Oh, absolutely.
So tell me, because that can be tricky. I just came back from the NBA All-Star Tech Summit in Charlotte, talked with a lot of the NBA team owners. They are very supportive of their players, and they get down on the courts, and we'll talk about social activism.
Yeah.
Tell me how you balance that with, especially when you're dealing with a lot of celebrities, who often have strong opinions on things.
Right, well, that's such a great question. First of all, the original influencer was Mrs. Estee Lauder
right.
in the mid-1940s, and she had this amazing vision that I think still holds true today, which was telegraph, telephone, tell a woman. And for all of the women in this room, I think we know that still holds true. It's really, really important to know who you're partnering with and really understand what drives their popularity. And again, you know, we all learned the best from our missteps. You've really got to understand if someone is fabulous and an amazing singer and they have a certain feeling like they are very much for veganism, you want to make sure your brand isn't doing anything that might be counter to that. And so it's a lot of work and more work today than ever to make sure you've got the right influencers that are authentic to you and in line with the values of your brand.
Catherine, talk to us a little bit about data, because that's another thing that is such a big theme. Doesn't matter what industry you're in, everybody is accumulating lots of data, trying to make sense of it. It really plays a much bigger role, right, in developing strategies for you guys.
It does, and we let the data drive the strategy. I'd like to go back to something you said earlier about ESG, because, and this is breaking news, my role is evolving, and I have been tasked now, because we've done so much with CSR, so much with the brand, so much with our communications team over the past 5 years, I've been asked by the CFO, to build an ESG function within Aflac.
Oh, congratulations.
That's great.
Condolences.
No.
But no, it's
good.
But it's interesting on two levels. First of all, we do a lot of really great things that are very authentic to our brand. We just don't have it captured in a way that the investment community is looking at it or would like to look at it. And with SASB and all of the new everything coming out and what becomes regulatory and what becomes best practice and all of that is yet to be seen. But it's just interesting to see that it came from the chief financial officer's purview. Because he's hearing it. It actually took me 18 months of working on my CEO to let me do our 3-year CSR program because we did the right thing because it was the right thing to do and that should speak for itself. And I took the data,
right,
which is basically exactly what you said. People want to work for a company they can be proud of, that shares their values, but they also want that company to talk about it and they want to be able to talk about it. And it was that piece of information that actually allowed me to get the green light from our CEO to start talking about this beautiful 23-year relationship with the Aflac Cancer Center.
And it's interesting, ESG, Stephen, and impact investing, because we, too, at Bloomberg have our own equality index. And I'm just curious that there are different definitions when it comes to impact or ESG. Mm-hmm. And I think slowly we'll move towards, I guess, you know, some norms and some standards. But how do you work that in when you're working with a company?
So we think of corporate responsibility, and ESG is certainly an inherent part of it. And whether you call it CSR or sustainability, the whole point is, it's a rubric by which you can assess what is your company doing to make the world a better place to live. And within that, there are two key aspects. One, there's what I call the truth serum, which is your perception of governance. Are you a company that's well-run, well-managed, but importantly, ethical, open, transparent in how you act? And then there's the sustainability slash citizenship measure, which is a respected environment, but also a respect to the social aspect of humanity. Are you committing to public causes that matter and people care about? So citizenship and governance are how we would measure ESG. There's also this element of workplace. It's a close cousin related to that if you really want to broaden the conversation to corporate responsibility, because people make decisions based on the values of the company and what you stand for. Whether you're a millennial coming out of school today, you're asking the question, what do you stand for as a company? Do your values align with my values? And by the way, okay, maybe you make good profits and good products, but I'm really curious to understand the role that you play in the world as a company. Increasing that makes you become an employer of choice and not just another company of option.
Yeah, can I just build on one thing you said,
please,
which is totally fabulous? I think one of the things, at least for me, is as this has gotten more and more momentum, I think there is this feeling of, oh my gosh, I have to be perfect. I have to be perfect. The goals have got to be rock solid. I've got to know in 2019 that I can meet that goal in 2025. And you know what? That's not true. You can do your very, very best. You can show progress. You'll learn along the way, and you might make some course corrections. But I think that it's really important to know that transparency does not mean perfection. Transparency means saying, here's where we are right now. It's actually not where we hope to be. Here's why we're not where we hope to be, and here's what we're doing about it.
But owning up to it.
Absolutely.
I want to throw out some polling questions. I think everybody's been told how this all works. And I'm curious, when it comes to kind of corporate reputational risk, how you folks feel about it, how you guys feel about this. So let's go to a polling question now, if we may. So if everybody can get on their phones, take out the app. I think it's the polling section. I think there's an icon with three bars. Here's the question. to you guys, to you guys. What do you fear, or what do you most fear when it comes to corporate reputational risks? And the choices are A, social media backlash, B, a customer data breach, C, unethical behavior, and D, is product recall. So as those things come in, unethical behavior.
Totally.
Not surprised about that.
Totally.
Let's start with Catherine.
It's mine as well. There's nothing worse in a crisis situation than knowing it could have been avoided and it was self-inflicted because someone did something foolish. And it takes a lot longer to overcome something like that. People will forgive you if you get breached and then you do all the right things. People will forgive you on social media if you fix their problem. Same thing with a product recall. It's hard to forgive human behavior that seems privileged or distasteful or inappropriate or illegal.
I would totally agree with that. I mean, unethical behavior, first of all, has no place at the Estee Lauder companies, but it means that you've broken trust, right? Mm-hmm. You've broken trust with your consumers and your employees and your stockholders, and then that can translate into, well, how do I know that, you know, there isn't something wrong with XYZ product? How can I believe anything that they say? So that is the number one watch out. And it's also where our work, I think, can be so important in terms of really just instilling at every single touch point the importance of integrity, ethics, quality, honesty, and again, not perfection.
Well, it goes back to transparency. Like, you could say, okay, we screwed up, but you can't knowingly have people doing bad things.
Absolutely.
Stephen, when people come to you, companies,
yes.
Is it one of those problems?
Well, it could be. And what I would tell
you. Well, what is it most?
Well, what I would tell you, well, I've just ran the RepTrack algorithm to answer your question. So
you are a robot.
We've just literally surveyed 230,000 people around the world in measuring the reputation across the G15 economies. We must have a lot of smart people in the room because that would have been the answer, would have played back to you. And in many ways, where we are today, it's reputation judgment day for every single company around the world. What does it basically mean? Your code of ethics is critically more important than ever before. Whether you are the CEO or the janitor, at the end of the day, your reputation matters for everybody. And if you fall foul in the court of public opinion, unfortunately, today, you will be punished.
Okay, and I've been doing business news for a long time. I'm not gonna say how long. But why does it feel like we're in an environment where unethical behavior, there's more and more of it, and it seems like there are people who get away with it. And I'm not going to go into politics, but I do feel like we have these conversations. No, but to be fair, we have these conversations in our newsroom, and it just feels like, oh, my God, I can't believe that corporate executive did this or this politician did this.
Well,
this teacher did this, or this public official did this.
I think as a society, we're at a strategic inflection point where morality matters more than ever before. And a lot of bad behaviors are amplified. We talked about social media. You could build a lifetime of investment in smart strategic marketing and communications to build a powerful reputation. One negative tweet about bad ethics could ruin it overnight. And so the impact of and the risk of things being exposed is also very much heightened. But I think we're just at a point in time in society where it's not that we don't care about making money and making profits. We just want to increasingly do it the right way.
Right.
We want to do it with mobility.
We can do it the right way.
We can.
We
have a conscious choice. We don't have to be greedy to be successful anymore.
Got another polling question. Let me just throw it out and then we can continue. This one is, you wake up one morning to an absolutely fierce and uncontrollable storm against your company. How do you respond? A, you tweet back. B, you wait 24 hours, plan, respond. C, you go radio silent. And Catherine, did you want to jump in on what we were just talking about?
I did a little bit because you mentioned when a company comes to you, we come because we know that doing good is good business and we're looking to measure it. It doesn't necessarily mean anything's wrong.
Okay.
I just wanted to put that on the record.
No, that's interesting. Yeah, I mean, of the companies that come to you, how much are in kind of crisis mode? How many are like, we got it, but we want to be better.
Well, I think if you get to see a doctor a lot of time, you're very, very sick, it's probably a little too late, right? So ideally, we'd be working with companies ahead of the curve. And what we've learned is that your ability to proactively manage your reputation is more effective than crisis management. Why? Because you put emotional equity in the bank.
I love this concept.
And when you need it, you can trade off it. And hopefully that time won't come. But unfortunately, for most companies, it will. So if you have that positive emotional buffer, the emotional equity already attributed to your company, when your crisis will come, you'll be better insulated. And in that regard, you can look at reputation as both an economic multiplier in good times and insurance policy in bad times.
Let me just look at this survey. So you wait 24 hours, plan, and respond. Do you guys have any thoughts on that, Alex? Go ahead.
I'd like to just build on that. Sometimes you don't have 24 hours. And so the second, you know, we're all 24/7, the phones are on. If there is something that's trending in any part of the world, our crisis team knows about it, and we get together very quickly with our outside advisors, and we try to understand what's underneath that, right? So if it's just an unhappy person who's unhappy, or if it's a real systemic problem, the strategies to deal with that are going to be quite different. So one of the things that is sort of a mantra of mine, and I'm not very good at adhering to it, is you got to wait a beat, right? Wait a beat, do the research, find out what's going on, really understand it, and then come back with a strategy, messaging, positioning, et cetera. But it's really important to get underneath that before you go into action.
Take a beat, but you got to go fast.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
But there's a curveball here, and it's called fake news. So how do you know the thing that's being promoted or discussed is real?
We've seen it in the news industry, fake press releases that have come out.
So as a human being, what do? We fact check. We look at our sources. And where data can help you is you can identify, is that a risk to our company? So if you have a risk playbook to say, here are the three things that could really hurt us, and that's not part of the subject matter of what's being discussed here, maybe you'd be a little less worried. So if you can find a way to kind of link what is my reputation to some of the reasons why, and you can monitor real time the sort of the mining of the social media discourse, you're now better prepared for risk, and then you can decide with intelligence how to respond to those kinds of issues.
I want to talk a little bit about profit and reputational balance, because I'm always curious about how do you manage that, right? The importance of having a good corporate brand, a good corporate reputation. But again, you've got to think about the top and the bottom lines, right? And certainly the C-suite, I think you had said to me it took a few years, right, to get your CEO kind of convinced that this was kind of some of the right things to do to bring in these guys. So tell me, first of all, you shared with me an amazing stat about corporate reputation and what it translates into.
Sure. So first off, a bit like Spider-Man, with sort of size and power comes responsibility. So companies who are especially profitable need to demonstrate to the world at large they're trying to do the right thing. In other words, they're putting all those great profits to good use and not just paying off the shareholders and paying dividends and making everyone else happy, financially speaking. I think Carly alluded to it earlier that we have identified in studying reputation over many years that a one-point swing in reputation translates to about $1 billion in market cap deviation, or 2.6% specifically in terms of market valuation. That now makes the stakes of reputation very, very important. Given that reputation is moving daily as a market's moving daily, you see the relationship that exists between your ability to run a profitable company that is highly purposeful, that is putting both people and profits into consideration, are the ones that are going to outperform the market. So in many ways, being a responsible corporate citizen is the path to greater profits, which is a little counterintuitive to the rhetoric of the growth of the stock market. But today, doing the right thing can yield significant dividends.
Do you guys have thoughts on that?
I would say there's absolutely no difference between doing the right thing and having a great, you know, whether it's a CSR program, sustainability program, et cetera, and profits. You know, you can cut corners and you can make profits for maybe a quarter, maybe a year, but going back to transparency, if you're doing things in an unethical and crummy way, you're not going to be sustainable.
Agree. So we only have a couple of minutes left here. I'm trying to figure out where to go. If you were giving advice, I'm thinking this is about corporate brand, about corporate reputation, managing the risks. What would be some advice, Alex, that you would share with our audience?
Oh, gosh, there's so many pieces. One thing that I will tell you that totally changed our lives at the Estee Lauder companies is that we live by real-time market research. And so we all have opinions and we have feelings and people think they're experts. And we know that we don't know everything. And so quick example, one of our brands, Origins, which is a fabulous brand, was, you know, a naturals brand, was looking to add cannabis to its face creams, actually a mask. And, you know, we were imagining the conversations. I'm like, God, pot, you're putting weed in, you know,
Martha Stewart is investing in a cannabis company. Just
right,
that
so
this
there
morning.
You go. So we were able to work with the brand president to very quickly do market research to find out, oh my gosh, we would love it. Hurry up. We need a what's called now Be Calm mask. And so that kind of
real... We all need it.
Yeah, totally. But that kind of real data is you can go in with your feelings and what it looks like and what you how you think it's going to play. And when you have those numbers, that totally takes the day. So I am so grateful. We use a company called Berland Team out of Edelman, or was it Edelman? And they're just spectacular. I mean, they help us do our job so much better.
Catherine, a piece of advice for our group.
You bet. I'm a data junkie, but you covered it so beautifully. I'd like to pivot back to the human element for a moment. And I want to talk about not D&I, but diversity, equality, and inclusion. If you don't have an inclusive culture, you will never have a diverse culture.
Yeah.
And if you don't have equality, you will never recruit and retain the best talent. At Aflac, we're actually at parity in gender pay. We are almost half ethnic minority, and we're 70% women.
That's fabulous. That's amazing.
Thank you. It didn't happen overnight. We've had the same CEO for about 38 years, same thing, family business that went public. But it matters. And what gets measured gets done.
And the research has shown a more diverse employee base, C-suite. You do see it impact on the financial top and bottom line. You can give a piece of advice, or you can talk about your latest survey.
Sure.
Because I thought that was
kind of
cool.
We could give lots of advice to various companies. And those around afterwards, we're going to be having a Q&A outside for a few moments. But we are, as you say, about to reveal the Global RepTrak 100. It's our 20th odd year of running this survey. And we're about to reveal on March 7th who the most reputable companies in the world. So I guess it's a bit like the Oscars for corporate communications in many ways. A couple of key learnings from what we're seeing, because it's not our opinion, it's based on the reflection of the research and the data. I talked earlier about today is reputation judgment day for many, many companies. And so being assessed on good ethics, and not just acting with good ethics, but getting credit for good ethics. Don't be bashful in celebrating morality. Celebrate integrity, celebrate telling the truth, be trusting, all the right things. But don't be bashful. Take credit for the good things you're putting into the world. I think secondly, we've talked a lot about the importance of influencers. Mm-hmm. Understanding who the influencers are in the market can allow you to yield competitive advantage. They're 6 months ahead of the curve of the current reality. They're either your biggest friends or your biggest foes. Which would you prefer? Actively engage them, find ways to manage them. And I think thirdly, don't lose sight of the fact that you can't win a reputation on products and services alone. Sometimes the default is, let's put all the money into marketing, let's drive more sales. Well, the truth be told, only 33% of the entire weight of your reputation is defined by your products and services. 66% is defined by your enterprise, around governance, around leadership, around citizenship, around financial performance. So maybe the one big key learning is, people will not buy your products and services unless they first buy into your company. Always remember that. Always put your enterprise before your products and services.
Great way to end. Thank you, everybody. Stephen, Catherine,
thank you.
Alex, thank you so much. Thank you, everybody.